On.
Oop.
Here's Dave. Oh, Lisa, what do you say? Where's that handheld mic? Here it is. There we go. How y'all doing this morning? Well, it's almost lunchtime, isn't it? Now listen, anybody? Okay. I guess we'll be hurrying it up. Now y'all get hungry or something, just know there's some wonderful cookies and coffee back there in the fellowship hall. We won't miss you for the first 30 minutes of service, you know, if you want to go do that. It's always great. Glad you're here for worship. Lisa Greeno.
Good morning. Thank you. Good morning, everyone. I'm the Children's Ministry Director here at Church by the Sea, and we are having an open house. And if you didn't get an opportunity to come see our classrooms today before the service, come see me next week before the service. We have great new little libraries in each classroom, and we're just blessed for all that everyone has done to make this happen. And it's just a wonderful thing for kids to be able to take a book home and it relate to God's word in their life today and share it with friends. So we're so excited about our library. And we have our Easter picnic coming up, April 8th.
Easter picnic. Now, Easter picnic is...
Yes, pastor's cooking. Yes, he's good at the barbecue. And we are going to provide hot dogs and hamburgers, but we would love for you all to come. It's for all ages, not just children. Of course, we have an Easter egg hunt and fun things for the kids, but it's a great time for us to fellowship together, enjoy food, and celebrate before Easter. So come on out. It'll be at Boga Ciega Millennium Park. It's all in your bulletin. And if you'd like to sign up to bring a side dish or a dessert, and Pastor likes deviled eggs. Mm-hmm. So if you'd like to bring some of those, come on over, see me, sign up, just so we don't have, you know, 30 plates of deviled eggs. And we'll enjoy ourselves and have a great day. And it's from 10 to 1. But if you can only come out for an hour or two, that's great too. And it's April 8th on Saturday. So thanks for all your support. If you'd like to continue to support the children's ministry with their library, there are little envelopes on your way out. You're welcome to donate something. And we appreciate all that you do for us, so, and our kids. Thank you.
Thank you, Lisa. Thank you very, very much. You're in for a very special treat today because our youth are here to lead us in worship. Now, y'all hold on to this just a second. This is not just some little youth group. Well, I'm going to tell you, these are phenomenal young men and women who love God, and God has poured his love into their hearts, and they are the most dynamic, most fantastic young people. I wanted to call them children, but I can't do that. Young people that I'm going to tell you will stir your heart. You're in for a great treat. Now, let me introduce for you our youth pastor, Jonny Grubbs. Here's Jonny, come on.
Oh, wait, no.
Just let him. Yeah, I'm gonna just get lower.
Hey, y'all. What's up? Doing good? Yeah? Cool. I'm gonna ask you all to stand so we can worship together.
Take this fainted heart. I'll just invite you guys to go ahead and take a seat, relax a little bit. We're starting a good place. We're going to start by speaking with the Lord and then hearing from His Word. So at this time, I'm going to invite Hope up to open our service up in a word of prayer to our King.
Hello. Let us pray. Dear God, thank you for the service that we are about to have today, and that we pray that it'll go smoothly and quickly, and also that the day will go through just as peacefully. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Before I read our scripture reading, I just want to thank you guys for letting us invade your service. The youth really appreciate the chance to have a platform to share what God's doing in their heart, and so just want to thank you for that. Our scripture reading this morning comes from the book of John, and it comes from chapter 13. I'm going to read to you verses 34 through 35. It says, "A new command I give to you, love one another as I have loved you. So you must love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples if you love one another." At this time, I'm going to invite our ushers. We're going to worship the Lord through tithes and offerings. And during that time, Sarah is going to bless you guys with a solo. So.
Hello again.
We sing hallelujah.
band back up. And I would invite you to stand and worship with one more song with us. Thank you. Give our youth band a hand, isn't it? Aren't they a blessing? Each time we do one of these Youth Impact Sundays, I try to share something fresh with you guys, something we haven't share with you before about what God is doing in our student ministry to build his kingdom. We've shared about camp right after summer camp, or we've shared about service projects that they're doing right after we've begun those. And I realized that we haven't gotten a chance to share about our youth retreat. And then more recently, Sarah, who's been singing for you guys this morning, has gone to Costa Rica. And so there's this theme here of discipleship, of getting prepared and getting closer to God, and then going out and using those gifts for other people. And so the pictures you see right now are of the retreat. And it was just a weekend in October that we took just to grow closer to the Lord. And I'm going to have the students share about their experience and how God touched their lives.
Hi. I'm Sam. I'm gonna talk about the youth retreat that we went on a little while ago, and I really got to focus because I didn't use my phone. I got to get off my phone for a while, and it was great. And we did great worship with Jonny, and we did some nice songs, and it was super fun. Like, there was many activities to do, like canoeing. We did manhunt a couple times, and we played and went on the zip line. And it was super fun, like, being in God's nature, like the nature that he's made us. And we got to, like, learn about Jesus, like, without any, like, real distractions that weekend, and it was just wonderful.
I'm going to invite Silas to the stage to share about his experience.
Okay, so all of us got the chance to go on the retreat over the summer, and it was very cool because we got to do a whole bunch of stuff, like go to the petting zoo, and because they had goats and stuff, I guess. And so we went canoeing, and there was a zip line. But after all that, and in between all that, we also got to do worship, which is like we'd go in, we'd sing a couple of songs, and then we'd learn, we'd write in, like, these little notebooks. And that was really cool because we got to get away from all the distractions of the outside world and just kind of be ourselves, and it just doesn't matter. And we got to kind of, like, get together as a youth group and, like, at the fires at night. So that was pretty cool. I'm also involved with one of the things that we do with the Buena Vista kids from the I don't know, what is it called, but apartments. And basically, we get to do a thing called Kid Zone, and we kind of play with the kids and, like, share the gospel with them at the end. And they just, like, light up whenever they come in. They're always, like, super excited. And it's kind of cool to see that. And since over the summer when we went on the not the retreat, but the camp, we got to help them out. And, like, that was, like, our first time doing all of that, just, like, to be with those kids. And we were, like, we kind of want to do this a lot more, so we started the Kid Zone. And now we are doing the tutoring, where we go to the actual Buena Vista place, and I was blessed to be a part of that, and I got to help them grow in their knowledge of, like, their studies and also the knowledge of the Lord. Which is really cool that we kind of get to serve God, like, with those kids and just kind of stay with them and help them as they grow in their spiritual walk with the Lord. And I think that's just going to make heaven a whole lot cooler, just to have those couple of kids and, like, to see them in heaven and know them. That's just going to make everything a whole lot better. Amen.
I'm inviting Aaron to the stage to share about his experience with the retreat.
Whoa. Hi. Jonny said. And I went to the youth retreat. It was around mid-October, but in the early week of October, I talked to my cousin, who's now not with us, but with God, and I'm not gonna cry, I almost did last time, but that me and him, he was like a known person that to do drugs a lot, and now that he's gone because of them, it has opened my eyes, because at the camp, we learned that you don't, to keep your faith strong, even though you don't know what's gonna happen. And like with my case, that my cousin overdosed on heroin November 11th, and the trip was mid-October, like October 28th, and that it was teaching us to, like, here's life that you don't know what's gonna happen and there's gonna be troubles. And the whole time I was like, yeah, nothing's gonna happen because I'm living good life. And then a few weeks later, I hear in the morning from my mom that my cousin died, that I can't just, that at least one thing I'm happy about it is that he's no longer struggling with drugs or anything, that he's with God, celebrating that he's with God. And that, like, the whole trip, I was thinking, like, I was being ignorant about it, saying, yeah, there's no troubles in the world, and nothing's gonna happen, because it's life. I'm too young for this. And then November 11th, my cousin, 24 years old, overdosed on it. And it was like, the 18th was the funeral, and that it prepared me, because I saw my whole family upset, and I helped my cousin, his sister, who's my age, like, she was crying, and, like, because of the trip, I knew what to do when it came time for grieving and all that, because I never been to a funeral before that, and because of the trip, I can say that if it wasn't for the trip, I would not know, I would have not known how to react to my cousin's death, and I would have not known how to help my family, like, make sure they know that he's with God now, and he's no longer struggling with any addictions. That was the thing.
Moving on from discipleship, I want to take a minute to highlight service. And our discipleship, our time with Jesus, leads into this service. And so Sarah's going to come up and share. But before that, I think there's a video to kind of kick it off, just about her journey to Costa Rica. So we'll watch that.
Praise of mine. again. Okay, so as you see, I went on a trip to Costa Rica with my music department at my school, Keswick Christian, and it was incredible. Like, I have so many stories, but not enough time. Well, first, I just like to say, you know, I'm so thankful that God has given me such a passion and a love for music and wanting to use it to spread his word and share him with other people. You know, it was really cool because we would, like, play for all the little kids and stuff that had never seen, like, I play the flute, and, like, they had never seen a flute before, and so I would just, like, play for them, and then I'd let them, like, touch the keys and stuff, and it was really cool to see them, like, so touched by it, and, like, you know, music breaks boundaries, like, barriers, like, language barrier, it doesn't really matter when you're playing music, it just, and, probably the part of the trip that stuck out the most to me was when we went into, like, the inner city. When we went into the inner city and we, it was the slums. Like, let's just be honest. It was desolate, like, way beyond anything I've ever seen. And I've been on missions trips before, but it was crazy. Like, there were electrical lines hanging down and, like, the boards that you would walk on, like, they were all rotted and stuff, and, like, you had to, like, and, yeah. But we learned a song for, like, on the bus ride there, we learned a song, and it was Singing in the Rain, but in Spanish. And then at the end, we all shouted, Viva Jesus! And it was, like, I don't know if you guys have ever heard of the tutita. We do that at VBS. It's like, a tutita, yeah. So it was like that, but to Singing in the Rain. And so it was really fun for the kids. And but anyway, I have a point to this, I promise. So, like, we were walking to the feeding center after we had all gathered in the circle and sung, and because that's why we were there. We were going to the feeding center. And I had this one little girl that was like my little bud, and her name was Angelica, and she was like on my shoulders the whole ride there. And then when we went into the feeding center, like, you know, she was like sitting on me, and we were sitting on the ground, and she like kept trying to lay back, and like my mom came on the trip with us, and she was sitting behind me, and I like leaned up against her because that way she could like lay down, because that's what she kept wanting to do. And she like looked at me, she's like, Quien, who, like, who is that you're leaning against? And I was like, mi madre. And suddenly I just see the smile just like drop from her face, and she got really sad and detached. And it's just one of those moments where you realize, like, you know, sure, like, I've been through stuff, but I have a home, I have family, I have friends. And this little girl who's so innocent, you know, who's so beautiful and so joyous, has nothing. And it just hits you, you know, and it breaks your heart. But at the end, like after we like gave her the food and stuff, we had to say goodbye. And she came up to me, and she was like, bye, you know, like, adios, adios, mucho gusto, mucho, nice to meet you, nice to have met you. And she, like, just kept pointing to my necklace that they handed out these cross necklaces on the bus there. And she just kept pointing to it, and I was like, Viva Jesus, Viva Jesus. And she got the widest smile that I've ever seen on anybody's face, like, ever. Like, it's just, you know, even if you have nothing, you can still have God. And he can bring you through everything, and he can prepare you for anything. And, yeah.
How cool is it to see God work in the lives of our young people? Isn't that amazing? I want to talk to you today about discipleship and service. These are things that we believe are very important to anyone's life, and not the least the lives of our young people and our student ministry. And you probably never heard the name Edward Kimball. Maybe if you're really like historically savvy, you might have. But Edward Kimball was a Sunday school teacher way back when. He taught a group of rowdy boys. I don't know any rowdy boys. And he would teach these kids, and probably every once in a while thought about throwing in the towel. You know, he was like, this is kind of tough. But he kept planting seeds and in the hearts of these young men. And one of them came to know the Lord, and this might be better known. He became, this is D.L. Moody. And D.L. Moody was a famous American evangelist who preached to many. And he would, in turn, preach to a man named Wilbur Chapman. Again, these are little seeds of discipleship. Wilbur Chapman may be less known, but he preached to thousands. And in one of his meetings, a man by the name of Billy Sunday came to know the Lord. Billy Sunday would share, and a lesser known, maybe by some, but a guy named Mordecai Ham would come to know the Lord. And he would go to the town of a young man who was known by his family as Billy Frank. And he would come to that town to do a revival, and his friends would try to get him to come to that revival, and Billy Frank refused, I'm not going. And finally, one evening, he caved and heard Mordecai Ham preach. And when he did, he got saved. And today, we know him as Billy Graham. And it was all started in a Sunday school classroom with a bunch of rowdy boys. You see, discipleship is really simple. It's really just about showing people who Christ is so that they fall more in love with him. And as they grow closer to him, they begin to model his character. And then in turn, it follows in to service. So that's why it's so important in our student ministry that we present to our young people just a ravishing vision of Jesus. This is who Jesus is. And the young people get behind that vision and love Jesus and want to become more like him. So I'm going to make a case for discipleship and service in the lives of our young people, and starting with the unique importance of the discipleship of teenagers. And one of the things I think to note is that Jesus has things to say to our young people. He has things to say to everybody, but there are things that Jesus said that can apply directly to the lives of our young people where they're at. I want you to hear this from the book of Matthew. It says, "Woe to you, teachers of the law and Pharisees, you hypocrites! You clean the outside of the cup and dish, but inside are full of greed and self-indulgence. Blind Pharisee, first clean the inside of the cup and dish, and then the outside will also be clean." That's from Matthew 23, verses 25 through 26. Now, do you know how many young people are stressed out because they are so busy with the outside of the cup? I'm talking about the external, right? They have to look a certain way or be a certain way. They're trying to present themselves, present an identity when they haven't even formed it within themselves. And Jesus is giving them a pass saying, no, you can focus on the heart. You can focus on the formation of your soul. Jesus said, come to me, all who are weary and heavy laden. I'll give you rest for your soul. He's saying, yes, let's figure out where your heart is before we start worrying about the external. He says, wash the inside of the cup and the outside will be clean. And so that's why we emphasize with our young people, you don't have to be stressed out about the facade you put on and the mask you wear in front of other people. Just be concerned with who God's making you to be. And so I believe that Jesus has things to say to our young people. The theme of our retreat is an overlooked verse that's in 3 John. It says, "Beloved, I pray that all may go well with you and that you may be in good health as it goes well with your soul." It's all about the soul. And that's what discipleship is about. Our young people need to be given the freedom to focus on Jesus and the spiritual health of their soul in such a tumultuous time as growing up, as middle school and high school years. So discipleship is important because Jesus wants to reach out and begin to tend to our souls. But number two, discipling young people is important because God has given them a unique role in the kingdom. 1 Corinthians 1:27 says this, "But God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong." Our society really doesn't take younger people that seriously. But it reminds me of a group of fishermen that society didn't take too seriously. I don't know if you realize that, but back in that day and age, those guys were just lowly fishermen. There wasn't really like anybody cared what they had to say. But who did? Jesus. He came alongside and said, "Hey, come, you're going to be a part of this movement that's going to spark the kingdom in the world." And nobody gave them a second thought. And so I believe it's really important that we give our young people a second thought. God is calling our young people in much the same way, which brings me right into a case for service. First of all, nobody's going to serve without being first motivated by Jesus, and our students are no exception. So that's the first thing. Students must be motivated by the servant leadership of Jesus. "Whoever wants to become great among you must be your servant, and whoever wants to be first must be your slave. Just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many." That's from Matthew 20, verses 26 through 28. Listen, that is one of the hardest things to teach in an increasingly me-centered culture. This culture is all about self and me and my desires and what I want. And what we see here is an example of the God of the universe taking on human flesh and becoming servant of all. See, what happens is when we present that, I've seen it in our young people, I've seen attitudes change in an instant when we communicate that the God of the universe took on human flesh and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. And so we start to think that through, and soon our students are thinking, well, if God would do this for us, surely we can put others above ourselves. If God would do this for us, surely we can think of ways to be proactively helpful and compassionate towards other people. And so they learn from that example of Jesus Christ himself. My dad always used to say things to us growing up as we pursued music and arts and ministry and things. And he would say, "Listen, you might have gifts and that's great, but you are blessed to be a blessing." And you guys have gotten a chance to witness that firsthand through our youth. They're blessed with so much and these stories and this musical talent, and now they're blessing you with it. And that's part of discipleship and service, that we are blessed to be a blessing. But finally, and perhaps most importantly, to get our students there, we have to empower them to serve as the adults in their life. You know, in some ways, I kind of hate that 1 Timothy 4:12 has become kind of a cliche verse. It's like the quintessential youth ministry verse. Most of you are familiar with it. It says, "Let no one despise you for your youth, but set the believers an example in speech, in conduct, in love, in faith, in purity." That's a great message for our youth. But I think a lot of times we as adults miss what that message is for us as well. You see, Paul is writing to Timothy, as many of us know, but we forget to learn from the example of the author. Because if Paul is saying this, an extremely seasoned and experienced church planter who's got all this knowledge and experience, he's saying, "I'm willing to respect you if you're willing to invest in the kingdom. I'm willing to meet you where you're at if this is what you want. If you want to pursue God's kingdom, I'll help you do it." Paul is giving this young person the time of day to do that. And we have to be about the same business. You know, if you want to know why young people seem to accomplish less, it's because we don't place a higher expectation on them. But if we start to do that, we're saying we believe they can do it. We're affirming them, and you'll be surprised at the result. If we truly believe that nothing is impossible with God, he can certainly use young people in mighty ways. You'll be surprised how quickly a student will serve with enthusiasm when you empower them accordingly. So we've got to empower our students in much the same way that Paul the Apostle did. 1 John 4:12 says, "No one has ever seen God. But if we love one another, God abides in us, and his love is perfected in us." So 1 John 4:12. See, discipleship is simple. It's about falling in love with Jesus and learning to model his character. And service is just about demonstrating that love to others. My prayer for our students is that they would increase in these areas and go on to do mighty things for the kingdom by God's grace and through his power alone. Will you pray for that with me right now? Let's pray together. Father, thank you so much for our young people, Lord. I thank you that we don't have to look down on them because of their age, but that they can actually set an example in faith and speech and conduct, even in purity, Lord, that they can do these things, Lord. And I pray for the congregation and for myself, Lord, that we would be sensitive to ways that we can empower and encourage them, Lord. I thank you for your example of servant leadership, Lord, and I pray that you would just do away with anything in our hearts that is so me-centered, Lord, and that you would bring us closer to your heart for other people, a heart of service, Lord. I thank you so much for this morning. I thank you so much for each person that's in this room. And I pray all these things in your son's name. Amen. I'm going to invite our youth band up for one more song. And I'll invite you guys to stand as well and worship as you feel comfortable and are able. going to pray briefly before I dismiss you. But before I do, I just want to thank you. Thank you for giving the students this platform to share with you. We really appreciate your support in that way. So I just wanted a chance to thank you guys right back. So let's pray real quick. Father, thank you so much again for this day, and thank you so much for every heart that's in this room, Lord. I pray as they disperse and go back out into the community and to their daily lives, Lord, that you would make them aware of your presence in their life, Lord, and that they would go in peace in the power of your spirit. We pray this in your son's name. Amen. You're dismissed. Be blessed. Have a wonderful day.
Okay, cool.